Hoffman is here with us today. I'm just going to a little bit of preface to this. Jens, tolerating the virus, tolerating the complications of USC, having very, very little ability to deal with international guests, tolerating a really amazing one-day trip where he's come down from San Francisco and will be going home tonight. So we're super lucky, even though, you know, Jens is close, that he's here with us for the day and able to be so flexible to kind of make it work. He's doing 9 studio visits today by, or something to that effect, by kind of trimming the time and making sure that he can see all of you. And so we really owe it to him for being so flexible and cool about this. I have some stuff, and I know I'm gonna blow the pronunciation of a couple institutions, but I'm gonna just give you a brief introduction, although I think most of you know Jens's work about Jens. Jens Hoffman is one of the most critical young contemporary curators working today. He's worked globally since 1998 when he was assistant curator of the first Berlin Biennial at 24 years old. Jens has done curatorial work for the Guggenheim Museum, the Diaz Center for the Arts, Documenta, and the Porticus Kunsthalle. He's curated exhibitions at Kaisma Museum of Contemporary Art in Helsinki, the Kolsnichter Kunstverein in Cologne, the Kunstverein in Hamburg, Kunstwerke in Berlin, Los Angeles Contemporary Exhibits, as well as numerous other institutions in Europe, South America, and the United States. He's co-curated both the first Toronto Biennial in 2001 and the first Prague Biennial in 2003. From 2003 to 2007, he was the director of exhibitions at the Institute of Contemporary Art in London. Jens has curated solo exhibitions by John Bach, Tina Segal, Jonathan Monk, and Martha Rosler. Some of his publications include The Next Documento Should Be Curated by an Artist, and Perform, which he co-authored with Joan Jonas. Jens was trained as a theater director and studied stage directing and dramaturgy in the cultural society and cultural sociology at the Ernst Busch School of Performing Arts in Berlin. He holds an MA in performance studies from Das Art School of Advanced Research in Theater and Dance Study in Amsterdam. Jens currently lives now in San Francisco, which and asking that he'd actually just moved there in
last year,
where he's the director of the Wattis Institute of Contemporary Arts at the California College of the Arts, as well as directing the Cap Street Project's Artists in Residence program there. I hope that wasn't too chunky in my pronunciation and going over it, but the fact of the matter is it's quite a list of things, and I wanted to start also just by hinting a little bit at all of this starting in 1998 when Jens was 24 years old and just how much he has done, not just at his age, but as a young curator dealing with so many young artists and making such a difference in terms of what people were going to be seeing, not just in one place for an extended period of time, but really all over the world, which I think is rare. So please join me in welcoming Jens.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. It was very lovely. I'm very flattered. And thanks for having me. I'm actually excited to be here, and it's not such a big deal to come to San Francisco to Los Angeles. I do this probably 2 or 3 times a month, and I'm taking always every opportunity that I come to be here. I love LA. I've always been a big fan of the city, worked here many times, come to lecture. Many friends here, so it's great to be back, even if I don't see all these other things, but I meet a lot of new people, which is very exciting as well. Okay, so now we have a bit of a problem with the screen for some reason. Let me try something.
Is it looking different? Is the projection different than what's on your screen?
Right now there's nothing on the screen. Oh yeah, okay, maybe. Yeah, there's like all of a sudden this frame.
When you go to the next frame, does it have it on the side?
Yeah.
Just the white line around it?
Mm.
I'm not sure what it is.
Maybe you should go into it and expand it again.
Let's see what someone's actually on. It's kind of clever. Here we go. Thank you. planning to do today was to simply go and present a couple of exhibitions that I've curated over the last couple of years and sort of put the emphasis maybe on this idea of the curator as a creator, the curator as an author. And I think some of you might have read this text that I wrote, A Certain Tendency in Curating, which was a text that I wrote about 2 years ago for an anthology of writing related to curatorial practice, which was called Curating Subjects. The text itself, as I said, was called A Certain Tendency in Curating. The title is a reference to a text by François Truffaut that was titled A Certain Tendency in French Cinema, which for the first time outlined his influential theory of the author-filmmaker. And I, in the text, I tried to apply the idea and the theory of the director as an author to the idea of the curator as an author. And what I mean with this in this specific context is that over the probably last 2 or 3 decades, particularly in Europe, you've all witnessed a big change in curatorial practice in which curators who used to be probably more in charge of preserving museum collections and analyzing the works that were in those collections and displaying them in a scholarly fashion, became much more creative individuals in their own right. And it's probably fair to say that the person that had the biggest influence on that development was a Swiss curator with the name Harald Seemann. Apart maybe from his compatriot Hans-Ulrich Obrist, who in my opinion probably did most for the change in curatorial practice over the last decade, particularly during the 1990s. One thing now that I'm in the US that kind of interests me in respect to that is the question of why is there such a different approach in the curatorial works between North America and Europe? And, what I'm going to say for the next couple of minutes or during the lecture, I kind of probably stick to looking mainly at Europe and North America. And obviously there's lots of things happening in South America and in Asia and in Africa. But apart from South America, North America and Europe are the contexts that I'm most familiar with. So I think that the simple answer for the lack of maybe a more experimental curatorial practice as we find it in many places in Europe has, the simple answer would probably be to say, well, there's different funding structures in the United States and there's very powerful boards in museums and there's maybe more of an emphasis on academic and scholarly work. And I have kind of always felt that one of the biggest issues maybe in regards to this, and I mean, it's kind of open even if, you know, all different places have to go down the same route when it comes to a creative practice, that the lack maybe of a personality like Seemann has largely been the reason, in my opinion, for that non-development, I guess, of curatorial practice into that very particular direction of the creator or the author. And even though you have had people like, say, Stieglau or Walter Hobbs or Lucy Lippard, who definitely in their curatorial approaches were equally experimental and risk-taking, they never really had such an impact as Seemann had for some reason. So now I'm finding myself, after having been in Europe, in the United States, and you know what I might have said about, or what I said about the US might have sounded a bit critical, but one of the really big innovations I feel in the United States when it comes to art institutions and spaces for curators to work in is this very particular construction that is completely unheard of in Europe, which is this idea that you have an art institution within an academic setting that's connected to a college or university, which is where I'm finding myself in right now, which is the Institute, the Waters Institute for Contemporary Arts in San Francisco, which is connected to the California College of the Arts. And there are different examples of those type of structures throughout the United States. When you think about the Renaissance Society at the University of Chicago, for example, or the ICA in Philadelphia, or to a, you know, probably larger degree, the Hammond Museum or the Wexner Center for the Arts, which I think are sort of larger institutions that originated out of a similar position. So now we have that move of many European curators all of a sudden coming here to the United States to actually go and work particularly in those kind of positions. And many of my colleagues that I worked with previously on the other side of the Atlantic are now here. Maria Lindh is the chair of the curatorial studies program at Bard College, where she's also in charge of the exhibitions program in the galleries. Hu Han Ru, French curator, a Chinese-born French curator, is the director of exhibitions and public programs at the San Francisco Art Institute. Ute Meterbauer is the chair of the visual arts program at MIT. So there's sort of like all of a sudden quite a lot of European curators who are very closely connected actually to the idea of the independent or creative curator coming to the United States, especially I think due to these particular structures that exist here. And what is the interest in that? Well, I think on the one hand, I think that the lack of pressure in terms of audience figures or income in those kind of galleries is very important. What ultimately really counts is what happens in the gallery space and how that can be transmitted to the school to and connect to the programs of the faculty, etc. So that's something that we are working on quite a lot at the Waters at the moment. And I'm going to probably talk about this more towards the end of my lecture once I've shown a couple of examples of exhibitions that I've curated. So the first exhibition that I want to talk about is an exhibition that I curated in 2004. It was the first exhibition that I did when arriving at the Institute of Contemporary Art, and it was titled Artist Favorites. It was an exhibition that took place in two parts. And I don't know if many of you have been to the ICA, but if you have, you will remember that this is a relatively small institution. The gallery spaces are quite small. People always think of the ICA as being something like MoCA or like a big museum with huge galleries, but it's actually very small. I think it's probably some commercial galleries here in Los Angeles that are bigger in terms of their gallery size than the ICA. And that was probably partly the reason why I wanted to split the shows up, to really have the opportunity to work with a larger number of artists, which was sort of important, I think, for the nature of the program. So, when I arrived in London, which was about probably February, I had a very short amount of time to come up with an exhibition that was supposed to open in early June, which is quite an unusual short amount of time to put up a big show, especially if you arrive at such a prestigious place and you want to be ambitious with what you do. So I kind of looked a lot through the archives of the ICA and kind of wanted to do something that also would familiarize myself with the institution and its history. And what I did here was bringing together a lot of interest that I've had to that point. You know, on the one hand, I was interested in artists articulating their thoughts in regards to the making of the artworks and their influences, and you know, specifically through the medium of writing. So I wanted to tap into that tradition. Then I was interested in exploring further the relationship between artist and curator and see maybe how there could be different formats of how artists and curators could collaborate and work together, which was something that was sort of inherent in the history of the ICA. A very famous artist, Richard Hamilton, who had my position at the ICA in the 1950s, and somehow I was like very drawn to some of the projects he had did together with the Independence Group while they were running the ICA. So there's always been a really big influence on this from the side of artists onto the program of the ICA. So all of this somehow came together in this idea of artist favorites. And what I did was I invited about 50 artists who had previously shown at the ICA. I asked them to select their favorite work of art that was made between 1946, the year the ICA opened, and 2004, the time that we were finding us in at that particular moment. So it was sort of like an idea of giving an overview of what had happened in contemporary and modern art during the time that this institution has happened, but you know, inside and outside. On the one hand, through the artists that had exhibited there before, but also through them selecting things that they had seen somewhere else. Well, and here we go. This is in Los Angeles artists. This is a coincidence, but this is a selection of Paul McCarthy. And before I talk about this, I just wanted to point your attention towards also the exhibition design. I copied the design from the National Gallery, which is in the, just behind the ICA, and it's kind of a very, very different institution than what the Institute of Contemporary Arts. It's sort of, you know, the sort of old-fashioned, traditional, large Beaux-Arts museum, where the ICA has always been more of like a, you know, contemporary art space. It was more funky and really on the cutting edge. So here you see the selection of Paul McCarthy's favorite artworks. And well, the actual piece that he wanted us to show was impossible to show, which is the Matterhorn attraction in Disneyland. And we obviously couldn't bring this over, so Paul was saying, well, I'm going to think about something else. And I said, oh, well, wait a minute, let's see what we can do about this. And I got in touch with the archives of Disney here, and these are the things that they gave us. I mean, the images are really bad for some reason. So we got an oil painting. Oops, sorry. My daughter, my proud father. This is an oil painting of the Matterhorn that was given to Walt Disney as a gift when they inaugurated the show. These are three architectural plans. They are originals from the person who constructed the Matterhorn, like showing the insides and all the mechanics of how the sleds actually go up and down. And then in the far corner, you see four photographs where there's a ribbon cutting with Disney. And the first thing is the original attraction poster. And I actually happened to go with my daughter very recently to Disneyland this summer, and they still had that poster up there, which was really exciting. And I was thinking about Paul and the stories that he was telling me about this. And I don't know if you know that he was born in Utah, in Salt Lake City, and he was a rock climber, and he wanted to be a mountaineer, so he had like this big obsession with the mountains. And then his parents moved over here to Southern California. I think they moved back and forth a couple of times. But he, of course, missed the mountains, and at some point they were driving to an aunt who was living in Orange County, and they passed the Matterhorn, and he could see it from the highway, and ever since he fell in love with it. That's at least the story that he's telling us. I think he's also fascinated by it in terms of its sculptural form and its dimensions and the idea of it being a replica or some sort of model of the original, but because it's by far not as big as the original one. So what you see there in the center is the text that Paul wrote about why the Matterhorn has affected him. And of course he talks about Disney being the greatest artist of the 20th century. But you know, Paul always talks about this and with a very critical perspective, of course, and you know, the idea of the Disneyfication of society comes up a lot. So here, you know, this is an unusual selection, I think. Most of the other selections that artists made were a bit more straightforward, but I always like to begin with this one because it was sort of such an odd choice. But then once you actually know Paul's work and you know what he does, it sort of totally makes sense, and you see like almost the origin of all the things that he's been doing in this. Here's another shot from the lower gallery. In the back there's a piano piece, which is like John Cage's silent piano piece that was selected by Victor Tiranija, and three times a day we had someone coming in and performing the piece. Then the giraffe is selected by Yinka Shonibar, an artist from Nigeria, and the piece itself is made by Laura Ford. Just flipping through the images here is a piece that there was a bit of a land art moment going on, because this video here was a cross from the Matterhorn, and it's a video that Robert Smith made of the Spiral Jetty. I think many of you have seen that film. And it was Mariko Mori's selection, and again, this idea of like, well, how do we bring land art into the gallery? And luckily, Smith made this film himself, and it's a really fantastic document of the piece that he made. And over there, these two black pieces is the selection of Mikael Engren and Ingvar Dragset. They're two Scandinavian artists. They're not so well known in the United States, but they've been around quite a lot and work a lot in Europe and in Asia. And they said that they wanted to have these two pieces by another Danish artist. His name is Alfred Johansson, who was working in the late 50s and early 60s on
films and photography where he would build sculptures and do performances in total darkness. The audience would have to enter dark rooms and experience the change of light and be sort of deprivated from all the sort of common experiences of seeing and artwork. Next to it, there's a little shelf, and there's a letter that Johansson wrote, and he disappeared. No one really knows what happened to him. Sort of a bit of a Bastian Ader story. And that's the original letter that he left behind. It's now in the collection of his estate, and it was written in Danish, so there next to it is a translation.
What was his name?
Alfred Johansson. So, okay, you know, the thing was, I had never heard of this guy, and it was like in the late 50s, and all sounded a bit strange, like performances in darkness. So you kind of go and just do some research, and all of a sudden it sort of turns out those two guys have made this guy up. And since one of them is from Denmark, you know, all the mail, like the loan forms, would go to like Inga's mother's address, and she would write back in half Danish and English, and they would really work this whole thing through. And they didn't really tell me that until the opening, but I was kind of suspicious because I really couldn't find anything out about this guy. And the letter was completely absurd. He was, you know, was saying how the art world has become so overly professionalized, and it's all about, you know, selling work and the pressures, and of course he wrote that letter in Cologne, you know, and so it sort of was all a little bit too much. And interestingly enough, this was really the first time we ever showed these works, and now Alfred Johansson really has a career. They have been shown in several other shows, and I think it's always sort of kind of open whether or not, you know, people actually really know the story behind all of this. So André Calderé, one of the sticks there in the center, that was selected by Gabriel Orozco. And I think in the between were a set of invitation cards by Robert Barry. It's a famous piece where he has like an invitation card to invite you to an exhibition, and then you go to that exhibition only to get another invitation card to go to another show where you would get another card, and so on, and it would go full circle, and I think in total there are 6 cards. And then John Baldessari selected a set of very simple, very delicate, very beautiful drawings of Soloid. So in all these texts, the artists really describe whether there are sort of personal connections to these pieces. Sometimes they are really close friends that have an influence on them. The reasons why they choose these works is they're really broad and wide. And I felt it was really interesting in terms of how, what kind of mixture of artworks you sort of get together, and a completely different perspective and different form of witnessing really the development of contemporary art over the last 60 years. So here, for example, Maurizio Cattelan chose a work by Martin Creed. It's this infamous piece, Lights Going Off, Lights Going On, which created a big controversy in London when it was shown as part of the Turner Prize at Tate Britain 2 years before. And what happens is really simply that the lights in this corridor go on and off as it takes about every 10 seconds. And Maurizio was sort of, I guess, interested in seeing whether or not this would still provoke anything and really if anybody would bother. But I kind of had the feeling that he was like basically using this piece as an extension of his own practice, which has a lot to do with, you know, parody, with provocation and with critique in a sort of comical way. So here, I'm just like, there were more things in the exhibition. I'm just like quickly flipping through here. So for the second part, we changed the wall color. So the first one was like something that they would call like a surrealist gray, and there was a particular name also for the red. But these are sort of wall colors that really come from the painting galleries of the National Gallery. It's the same way it does the font and all that sort of detailed labeling. It's all appropriated from that classic museum, which was a stark contrast to how the ISA used before to look like. So here you have, for example, Carl André's floor, please, or one of them that was selected by Daniel Duran, and in the background is a painting by Andy Warhol called Vesuvio. Vesuvio was selected by Martin Creed. And his whole story was that he was actually living for a year on an island very close to the volcano, and every morning when he was looking out of this window, he had that view from the Warhol painting. It was sort of unclear whether or not he moved there because he was fascinated by the painting, or he wanted to have that painting because he had that view when he was living in Italy. But part of the piece was that he would come every day at 2 o'clock to the gallery and stand in front of this painting for 3 minutes to sort of have that view again. And here's another shot. There's these sensorial masks. It's a piece by Brazilian artist Livia Clark, and you're allowed to take those masks on and walk around with them, and they somehow distort your senses. You either can't really hear anymore, you can't really see. They have these long elephant-like noses where they're filled with herbs, so your sense of smell also changes. In the background is a piece by Rosamari Troco that was selected by an Egyptian artist called Gada Amea. And one thing that I really liked about this show, which was something that only really came to my mind halfway through the preparation, was that I had this very eclectic collection of artworks, and I really had to sort of make sense of them, and how do I display them, and how do I bring this together, because I didn't really select them, and that was sort of another concern of mine. And you know, like when you think about exhibitions, or you know, I guess group exhibitions particularly, you have like particular formats for group exhibitions, and like group exhibitions that look at a particular medium, like a painting show, photography show, or a certain group of artists, like art apogra or conceptual art or performance art, or you have like a show that's about a special particular geography, like all artists from Berlin or all artists from Tokyo. And then you have like variations of that, you know, painters from the 70s from Tokyo. And you can go on and on and on with this kind of thing. So I think in this exhibition, I kind of, managed to sort of go and bypass those classic categories of group exhibitions, which are somehow my aim. And one of the really important things for me to say with this exhibition was also that relates to the selection of artworks and the display, was like how much is the idea of the curator really based on an understanding of the curator being simply the person who selects work and has the authorities to select work. And is that really where curating begins, or where it starts, or where it stops? For me, the selection of artworks is definitely an important part, but it's really, for me, always only really where it begins. And thinking about the overall exhibition and its display and its design and its composition has been something that has occupied me far more than the simple selection, and maybe also sometimes interpretation of the works.
Who selected Li Zhenhuang?
Sorry?
Who selected Li Zhenhuang?
Ciro Meireles. This is a piece by... Who made this piece? I saw this piece on the bottom of a swimming pool in Los Angeles. Lawrence Wiener, selected by Liam Gillick. That piece was exactly on that wall about, I think, 20 years before. And we have another case like this, which is, I guess, my favorite piece in the whole exhibition, because the story is very touching. It's really good. this is cube, and it's a cube that Charles Ray made. I'm sure you're familiar with it. The outside dimensions are smaller than the inside dimensions, and in order to install it, you have to slip it into the floor, so you kind of cut the floor open, and then you put the cube inside, and it sort of plays with your senses, and this is a selection that C. Floyer made. Who, you know, of all of you who know her work will also say, well, she's an artist who plays with your senses. You know, she projects a slight projection, a light switch onto the wall, and you actually think there's a light switch, or the light under a door is just simply a slight projection. It's sort of this idea of irritation and playing with your senses and misleading you in some way and making you feel uncomfortable, not being able to trust what you see in front of your own eyes anymore. So she selected this cube, but the story that is, makes it so, in my opinion, such an outstanding selection is that Seal Floyer used to be a guard at the ICA. During the retrospective of Charles Ray's work in 1987, when that cube was installed exactly in the same position, and she was sitting in front of this cube for about 3 months in the whole duration of this exhibition, so she knew this thing inside out. And in her text describes really how these 3 intense months with this one piece in front of her all the time completely shaped what she's doing as an artist now. And then you look at the work and it just makes bang, yeah, of course, you know. It was like a wonderful story just to see, like, it's not even one artist, it's just like really one piece that this woman experienced for such a long duration. And she can talk about it forever and ever. It's really incredible. So, of course, to be a bit nostalgic and to really go all the way with it, we found the guy who installed that piece the first time 10 years ago, who's now in his late 60s, and he installed it exactly in the same spot. So we did like all the whole thing. And it was sort of sealed. We really wanted to do it all the way perfect. So this is artist's favorites. I don't know if you have any questions about this show at the moment. Otherwise, I can also move on to Surprise Surprise, which is a show that I did at the ICA again. It was 2 years after the other show. So the ICA changed directors, and the new director had a different idea of what the ICA was supposed to be. We had the pressure from the board that was always saying, oh, again, take more than 6 million visitors a year. How are we going to get so many people to the ICA? How can we be more popular? What can we do? You know, we really want to bring in people. And I mean, the ICA has about 400,000 visitors a year, which is for an institution of that size an enormous amount of visitors. But since Tate set the bar so high, the idea was that every institution should have at least 1 million visitors now. And everybody, all the institutions are cheating in the way they count their visitors. Like the Serpentine Gallery, they have put their clicker like outside of the door. So if you just like stick your hand in, you click. So they have like 800,000 visitors in that kind of thing. Or if you like connect in the park on Sunday, everybody has to go to pee. They go in there, click, click, click. But this became an obsession, you know? All of a sudden we had clickers at every door at the IC, everything needed to be measured and clicked. And so my director said, Jens, you know, I really like these shows with Charisma and Evans where we take off walls, and but you know, this time we should do something different. I really want to have a show with big name artists. So we made this show Surprise Surprise, where we invited like artists that I'm probably like the most obvious well-known artists that exist, like everything from Messi Barney and Damien Hirst, Kippenberger, Neil Rauch, Timans, you know, like the sort of blockbuster blue chip types. But I asked all of them to give me a work that was completely in opposition to what they were actually doing now or what they were known and famous for. And they, I think apart from maybe one or two, they all agreed to do that. And we were really playing with this idea of like, you know, of expectations in regards to being a visitor of an art institution and maybe receiving a card where you see all these names and people are saying, how does the ICA manage to get all these artists all in one show? It's incredible. And it was the biggest opening at the ICA ever. There were queues, people couldn't get in the door, and it completely worked. And once people were inside, well, some people really had a laugh, some people thought it was extremely provocative, other people were upset. But I think most people actually appreciate it, and I actually pushed it a little bit further than this, because I didn't put labels next to the pieces. So you wouldn't even know who made these things, and since there were almost no traces of the work that they're known for, it was really hard to say who these artists were, and you needed to look really, really closely. In most cases, I would say it was possible to understand, you know, to see where these works came from if you just spend enough time with it. And that was really my intention. You know, I wanted someone to really look at this painting there in the corner and see this woman. And I think if you were familiar with painting, somehow you would figure out that this is a painting by Albert Erlen. And this is actually the piece that gave me the inspiration for this, which is these pieces here. You can't really see them, unfortunately. It's a series of paintings that Rodney Graham made under the title Picasso, My Master. And I saw them at an art fair, and I think Miami Basel, at the booth of a gallery called Jon & Schöttle, a German gallery. I said, like, what is this ugly painting? And I went with a big respect of that gallery. So I go and look, and I see it's Rodney Graham. And it sort of totally made an impression on me. And I think basically, really on that premise, the whole show developed, and this idea of someone like Rodney Graham all of a sudden making these paintings. I think his intentions are different to how it has developed in my show, but it was definitely an inspiration. So here, what do we have here? These are paintings by Wolfgang Tillmans. And then this wig is like a wig of Keith Richards, the guitarist of the Rolling Stones, which is a piece by Richard Prince. And then next to it is like a photograph of him, like Richard Prince, and Keith Richards, and Richard Prince actually wearing this wig. And who made these photographs? These are actually Richard Prince looking photographs, but they were done by, God, I forgot, I'm sorry. It's been a while. Okay. This is a video piece by Carsten Höller with Japanese women saying, I say always the opposite of what you say, and the same video was on the other side of the room, and the person would say the same thing. So it was sort of like the entry piece, that when you came in, you would hear these two women saying, I'm always saying the opposite of what you're saying, and so on and so on. The next to it is a piece by Andreas Gursky, these large scale photographs, of which he's obviously known for, but here he photographed pages out of The Man Without Qualities, the novel by the Austrian writer Robert Musil. And he kind of worked on the text itself. And it's a description of a particular landscape, and there's a description of a scene on a market in the book. And when you read the lines, it's kind of almost like you could imagine a description of one of the Gursky photographs that he usually takes. So, and he told me that his galleries have always refused to show them. And they'd like say, oh, this is absolutely not like your work. So I said, oh yeah, I think we're talking about the right piece for our exhibition. And here's the Barbara Kruger piece, and that was really the piece that we put up in the entrance. You walked down into the gallery and had this statement there, which sort of, I guess, related to this idea that we always feel like, okay, we know what we're getting ourselves into when we look at art. We basically know what we want to see, and I kind of try to circumvent this with this exhibition. And of course, some people couldn't help it. Again, here, this piggy bank over there in the pedestal is a piece by the Chapman brothers, and they said they wanted to show something that they made in their teenage years, but it's a piece that they just made especially for the show. But it's sort of ironic about, you know, YBA artists and money and the commerce of the art world and their gallery.
What was that big thing in the middle?
Oh, this is a piece by Neo Rau, a German painter. I don't want to make that comical, but I phoned up his gallery and said, is there any piece like this for us? And he's saying, yeah, Neo made this piece that was supposed to be a work in public space, to be outside of the Bundestag, which is the parliament, but they rejected it because they thought it was too ugly. And he redid the piece. There's a second version of that piece that exists, which is sort of, I think, where he took some of the criticism into account. And so Julie Lübke, the owner of the gallery, Eigen and Art, had this thing in his storage. And I thought that's really interesting because this is like really far away from what you usually see when you look at Neo Rau's work. I mean, one of the reasons to do this also with like very well-known artists was simply the fact that I was really hoping that most of the audiences would at least like know half or a quarter of the artist and could sort of begin to play this game and understand it, you know? And it's sort of, I'm showing this also in succession to the artist's favorite show, because I think there's a strong relationship with that as well, to that exhibition. All right, all the way to Los Angeles. A show that I actually did before I did the Surprise show. I don't know if any of you have seen this exhibition. Okay, no one was here at that point, I guess. Los Angeles Contemporary Exhibitions up on Hollywood Boulevard invited me to make a show. They said like that they wanted to have somehow an outsider's view on the city of LA. And I already had made a big show in Los Angeles maybe 2 or 3 years before the project, where I was investigating artists here in Los Angeles and bringing everything, my whole research together. And the whole exhibition was basically a documentation of that research. And that's also how I got to know the people at Lace, and they had no money, was really little budget, and I was thinking, well, what's the most awkward thing that I could as a European bring over to Los Angeles, something that's sort of very apparent and almost like a cliche or a stereotypical idea of Los Angeles. And of course it's the notion of always being in cars and always driving, whereas when you walk much more. So what I came up with was a series of walks that artists would do to, through particular neighborhoods in Los Angeles, neighborhoods that they either grew up in or had a particular affinity with for some reason, or there was a particular relationship to their biography and their work. And those walks would take place outside the gallery space, and I think like Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and I think there were about 10 walks, and all done by artists from Los Angeles. And this is what you would see the first day inside the exhibition space. So these like patterns there are actually the grids of the streets, and the red lines. I think maybe I have a close up. Yeah, here for example, the red is like the line of where you go, and there was also a guide, like a little catalog that you could get if you wanted to go on the walks on your own without the artist, and the artist would describe why he or she chose that walk. And here, for example, Baldessari's walk was from his studio in Venice to his studio in Santa Monica. The colors green and blue and red and gold were all taken from the seal of Los Angeles County, and kind of really used simply really as a form of illustration for this project, but also thinking about their meaning within the seal. You know, gold is prosperity, and blue is infinity, and green is like, what do you call this, like the vegetation. And Matt Cranston's walk, this is Eric Wesley. Okay, so then there was a second part to the show. So every time there was a walk, every person who went on that walk got a little disposable camera and were asked to document the walk. So while maybe John Baldessari or Matt Cranston would guide people around, the audience was asked to take pictures. So we collected these photos, cameras after each walk, and we put them up in the space next to where the map is. So little by little, over the period of the exhibition, the accumulation of the photographs grew, and almost took over the whole wall. This is maybe like halfway through. And what I was interested in here was really sort of like playing again with the notion of the author, who is really the person who is creating this exhibition here, whether it's the artist, the curator, or the audience itself. And it somehow seems like a big collaboration of all the three elements that come together. I was kind of really happy about this exhibition because it was a sort of very subtle little gesture in some way, but it had it felt like something that was round and worked. And I think it did this like for a $7,000 budget, including a little catalog. So I was actually quite happy. And this is sort of like an experience that it always sort of taught me, where like I rather work with some restrictions, and usually that makes me even more creative. And that was something that really came through for me as an experience with this show. So here, Ruben Ortiz Torres took everyone to the Fata in East LA. Has anybody been there?
To where?
This is to East LA. This is like this guy here, and he has a muffler shop in East LA on Whittier Boulevard, but it's a kind of private museum, Wunderkammer kind of thing. And he has probably about like a million objects there, and everything is painted in these colors, and it's a huge, gigantic, total artwork basically, and it's still there. This is probably about 20 minutes ride from here, and it's absolutely fascinating. And Ruben Ortiz Torres, are you familiar with who he is? Yeah, Mexican-American artist who lives here in Los Angeles. Knew about him and took us all down there, and was very, very fascinating. One of the things that I thought was really nice also, of course, with this was that, usually the audiences that go to laser, that go to museums in LA, are not necessarily the audiences who walk. And, they are the people who have the cars. So sort of maybe spoke a little bit also about the class structure of Los Angeles, because there were people who were saying, oh, East LA, do you really want to go there? Isn't it dangerous? But no, it wasn't. So this was, I think, Jennifer Bornstein's walk in Griffith Park. She took everyone on a sort of fake ranger tour that she was conducting herself. And she spends a lot of time in Griffith Park. She told me that she almost sees it as her studio and a place for a lot of her inspiration. And as I said before, these are all pictures that are taken by the visitors or the audience, the participants.
These are all the photographs from the Baldessari walk, and Baldessari gave a particular instruction. I mean, this is sort of like uncanny, because you know the work of Baldessari, and then you see these pictures like, oh yeah, John must have taken that. So what he said is like, to everyone, while he was walking around and talking about the history and change of Venice and Santa Monica, he said that please photograph every stop sign, every traffic light, every you know, name of the streets, everything like that, from one studio to the other. So you can see it's like a total Baldessari work. All right, so the next exhibition that I want to talk about is a show that I did in London last year, very abstract and hyperfigurative. It was in a gallery, a commercial gallery called Thomas Dane. It's an exhibition about painting. And Thomas Dane is in St. James. It's kind of in the center of town, very close to Piccadilly Circuit. It's a part of town that's kind of very well known for its old master galleries, antique bookshops, and has this kind of quality of old London. Even though Thomas Dane is a contemporary gallery that shows younger, emerging contemporary artists, but Thomas has a big fascination for painting, and I never really shared that. And so we had often, I've known him for a couple of years, often long conversations about this, and he always tried to, you know, bring painters to my attention, not necessarily even from his gallery, just in general. So at some point he asked me if I wanted to make an exhibition for him, and I said, well, if I do a show for you, then it has to be a show about painting. And it was also really at the moment, I think we probably had as much as we did that in London or in Europe, like a big comeback of painting, especially in commercial galleries and lots of painting shows taking place, and I sort of wanted to get my head around this. And but my whole strategy towards this was, oops, what happened now? It just collapsed. Was that sorry? I think there's no. Okay. Was that I wanted to create this fictional museum, which is called the Museum of Modern Art and Western Antiquities, and kind of like modeling it a little bit after Rothaar's Museum of Modern Art, and kind of state in that fictional museum, in that space itself, that you were actually witnessing the moment when painting really died. This is like after the death. It's not like the death is happening anymore, you know, what we always talk about, but it actually occurred, and it occurred in 2007. And we are like in the future now, and we're looking back at the medium, an artistic medium, from another era, or from like another cultural context. And that's why I designed these vitrines that are modeled after vitrines that I found in the British Museum, where they have their oceanic exhibits in. Around all of this, we created a design that sort of mimicked most of those old master galleries that exist in that area, with these green walls and particular labels that sort of had like gold letters on. And it's almost like as if the curator of this exhibition didn't really know how to exhibit painting, because he put this in these vitrines and put them on strings, and it's really that far away that we don't even remember how to show these things. The only thing that this curator remembered was that somehow the color has to be on the front and the frame goes in the back. But then at the same time, of course, I was interested in talking about painting as an object, or paintings as objects. And also maybe paintings as commodities. When you look at the back of the paintings, you often have these stickers that say through which hands these paintings have gone, like different galleries, different dealers, different collectors. And it's almost like a little biography of a piece on the back. And it's also really interesting when you see sometimes a painting, it's really well made on the front, and then you turn it around and it's like so messy, and you can really tell what's going on in the studio of the artist. So like Sarah Morris's painting, absolutely perfect spot, nothing. Yeah, I've never seen a more sophisticated frame and stretching as hers. So we had these two different vitrines. One was abstract painting and one was figurative painting. And it was sort of like talking about these very simple categories, how we define painting often. You know, oh, what is that type of painting looking like? Oh, it's very figurative. Oh, it's very abstract. So it sort of follows that sort of very simple notion, only to sort of course, to discover that, you know, the borders are very blurry when you start looking at it further. So there's one vitrine here in the main space with abstract work.
and that's what, you know, the figurative is supposed to be. You see these little labels down there, and we cover the floor with like this green felt, and really sort of completely mimic this whole look of it.
Yeah, I mean, was it being able to ask painters, I mean, anyone in this case, but specifically with a painter, that you would be able to do this degree of recontextualization and thematizing around their work? Was there resistance, or do you feel that it was something that you've over time been able to develop as a curator, something that, you know, they will trust you or they will understand it as a curatorial project and go along with it?
Well, I think there's different things that play a role there. On the one hand, I think, yeah, you're right, there's probably something like a reputation where the artists say, okay, he has done this and that and this, and somehow, you know, it might be interesting to participate in this. We all know that's maybe something different. But, you know, I had a lot of dialogues with all the artists. I think I spoke to all artists who were in the exhibition, apart from those three, I think, who are not alive anymore. I think the only one who didn't want it to be in the show was Luke Timmons. And what's her name? We just had the show at the Hammer.
Toma Arts, yeah.
And Toma Arts just won the Turner Prize, so I think she was kind of busy with other things, and we never really discussed it. She was just saying simply she was too occupied, and Luke Timmons was, yeah, he was really strongly against the whole idea.
Just out of curiosity, how had he felt about Surprise, Surprise? Because he was part of that, right?
Yeah, he liked that. The person who didn't like that one was Daniel Durin, who I'm actually good friends with and worked with a lot of times. And then Durin was like sending me an email and says, Jens, you should know my work is always a surprise. So it has a lot to do with talking to the artist. And you know, once you actually make that effort and you talk to them and you visit them, particularly the ones that were in London, I think they all understood that I was looking at it critically, but I think they felt like it was something that was probably more interesting and stimulating than just being in a group show that looks at the painting in a very straightforward fashion, where there isn't that problem maybe articulated that painting often is confronted with, or this critique that painting is confronted with. I think once some of the artists came to see the installation, I remember, what's his name again? A German painter from Dresden, not Neo Rauch, someone who, another one who was very well known. Any painting fans here?
What's the work like?
It's a figurative work taken from usually found images from newspapers. Maybe I have it here. No. Anyway, he saw the installation and he sort of grew more and more skeptical while he was in the space. And I think, I don't know, I had the feeling that he kind of regretted maybe to be part of the show. But others were really enthusiastic about it. I'm doing a show like this right now again for Thomas Dane as a second part, which is going to copy called Monumental. And it's a sort of a bit of a critique towards the unmonumental show that happened in the new museum, but also a continuation of a similar exploration of the field of sculpture in coming off from the painting show. But it will be a different exhibition. It's going to be like in a year from now. And I think then we could put that chapter to rest, but I kind of felt it would be interesting to do at least two of those exhibitions of this fictional museum. So here you see some other images. Anselm Reile, William Zassner, Sarah Morris. And there's Wade Guyton with the axis.
Is that Richter or somebody making a joke about Richter?
That's Richter. On the it's a photograph from the October magazine, an article of Rod Richter, where he had his face taped with, you know, like, what do you call this, scotch tape?
Yeah, but is that his
painting? Messing on Tetzel made that painting. I mean, you can see, what was nice was also really to see all these paintings from the back, and it had like such a great
quality in itself to see all these frames and canvases and the things that were written on them and the stickers. And this was a show last year, again in a commercial gallery. It was called For Sale. It was the invitation card, kind of made after, you know, like a classic for sale sign. It's the outside of the gallery, and it's like a shot from inside. And the premise of the show was that I was invited again to make a show in a commercial gallery. And I've done this a few times, and sometimes I kind of play with that idea, what am I doing as a curator in a commercial gallery, and you know, what does this all mean, and why do commercial galleries invite curators to do shows there, and how much do they actually really want to be involved with, like, you know, articulating ideas, and how much is that, you know, maybe also about coming across as being involved with the production of knowledge and these kind of things. So here I came up with this exhibition where I said to the owner of the gallery that I wanted to make a show that consists only of work that address that they are in a gallery, that they're being shown in a commercial context, and that if you as a collector want to buy one of the pieces, you have to buy the whole show in its entirety. Not one single piece could be sold individually, and they had to stay together. But when they were bought together, and I made this structure that you see, the ceiling is lower, the walls are pushed smaller, it's like a 30% scale model basically of the gallery, so you would even get those plans, how to build the scale model, and had to buy the whole exhibition. It's sort of related to some other questions that I have had in regards to curating and exhibition making, in contrast to maybe art making, where you still have often some evidence of what has happened, you know, or you actually have even an object, a painting, a sculpture, a photograph, and as a curator you're often left, you know, with just simply having a catalog or some photographs of the exhibition. So here I was kind of thinking, well, what would happen if the collector would actually collect the whole show? And that may be some interesting model for the future, because you kind of think, wow, wouldn't it be amazing if, like, we could still see a show that was done in the 1930s, you know, like Duchamp's surrealist show in Paris, or When Attitudes Become Form, like, you know, sort of landmark iconic exhibition. They would have been collected and they could be restaged and you could actually see and visit them. So sort of like some ideas of that maybe relate more to my profession and some of my thinking around that. So all the pieces in the exhibition somehow related to the fact that they were shown in a commercial gallery, and no one of course bought the whole show, even though we had a couple lesson of requests. But once the artists knew that that was the idea, they also put the prices so outrageously high for their pieces. And the price of the whole exhibition was the sum of all the individual prices of each piece. And I think it was almost like $1 million.
Why would they put them higher?
I think because they wanted to sabotage the idea. Mm. But for me, it was sort of like interesting, you know? It was sort of like, okay, if we sell this, then I've succeeded with this idea of actually selling a whole show, which would probably, you know, be a satisfaction for me, would be an interesting incident. If I don't sell it, I kind of have found a way of how we can actually go around the market and have, you know, there's a limit to what the market is actually, you know, able to do or what it wants to do. It might be that if you would have done the same show with different artists in a Gagosian gallery, that, you know, that gallery would have found someone to sell it to. So, you know, it's like a, you know, very nice and well-known gallery in Lisbon, but, you know, apart from that, there isn't much of a context for, you know, and there are no institutions there, and so that was sort of like the story. Here, this in the center is a piece by Michael Engel and Ingrid Raxit, who made a model of the model and put that in the gallery, which itself then of course had another model, so it's a sort of Matryoshka thing. So you could buy their piece, which was itself there. There in the background is a piece by Tauber Auerbach, Monet. This little sculpture here is a piece by Arabella Campbell, an artist from Vancouver, who had been the gallery director at the gallery Catriona Jeffries. And all her works have, I don't know of any of the pieces that they were sold on. I mean, here's this is a piece by Andrea Fraser where she becomes the dealer. I don't know if you guys have seen this. It's her walking in the gallery and giving a tour of the show and changing character. So sometimes she talks about her personal relationship to the artworks, and it becomes very romantic and almost sentimental. And she talks about what a great investment these pieces are, and like the different types of dealers that you would expect, you know, some people who push your buttons because they think you're like interested in speculation, and others that, you know, you might like a romantic or sentimental story. And this piece in the back is very, very nice. It's done by an artist from London called Carrie Young, the £13,000. And she went to a laboratory and had two scientists figure out how much her body is worth if she would sell it to research, and all the minerals and all the different aspects that her body is constituted from, and the worth of an artist of her size and weight would be at that particular moment in time £13,000, which was of course then also the price of the piece. This is a piece by Maria Eichhorn, who did three interviews that discuss a contract that Seth Siebler wrote about the relationship of artists and galleries. And I think the interviews were with Adrian Piper, Lawrence Wiener, and Daniel Duran. Yeah, this is another show. And here you see sort of how we had actually made the construction, how that looked from the back. All right, so there's two more shows. We're almost there. And I'm going to quickly talk about this one and then look maybe a little bit more detailed in the final one. Pioneers was the first exhibition that I made at the Waters, and it opened in September of last year. And it was sort of a bit of a similar situation as with the ICA, that I wanted to familiarize myself a little bit, not only with the institution, but also with the city and the region. And unlike the ICA in London, the Waters doesn't have like a 50 or 60 year long history. It's only 10 years old. But San Francisco, of course, has a really beautiful and illustrious history. And one of the aspects that interested me when I arrived there was the history of the gold rush and the pioneer era. And I was also thinking about the term pioneer, related to the context of art and pioneering artists. You know, artists who went out and broke new ground, and somehow combining these two notions of the pioneer, breaking new ground in your field of art, but really literally breaking new ground if you're thinking about the settlers and miners, and you know, the idea of looking for gold is maybe also something that sort of has to do with some aspects of what I do as a curator when I go out and do research and things like that. So what I did for Pioneers was bring together an equal amount of artworks that were produced throughout the 20th century by pioneering artists from the Bay Area, as well as artifacts that are related to the pioneer era. And the pioneer era itself is sort of defined roughly from 1849 to 1906. And 1849, of course, the moment they found the gold in the Sierra Nevada, and 1906, the year of the big earthquake and fire in San Francisco. So from that period, I had about 50 or 60 artifacts in the exhibition that related to that history, and juxtaposed them with artworks from throughout the 20th century. And both were, as I said, displayed and exhibited alongside each other. Both were following a timeline. So the first piece that you saw was lithograph of San Francisco, how it looked in 1849, and next to it was a painting from a Chinese artist, an abstract painting of a street scene of San Francisco approximately 60 years later. And so you sort of followed in the exhibition this sort of coming and going of artifacts, memorabilia, historical material, and artworks. In the center here, for example, is a boat. This was the first. It's a model of a boat. It's about I think from 1853 or something. I think was very famous for being.
was called the Boston Rover. It was a long story about it being the first boat that ever entered the bay after the announcement of the gold rush and then going back and forth between Boston and San Francisco. And this whole story of how people went to California, you know, these different ways over land, by sea through the Panama Canal, or really around South America, it's all really extremely fascinating. And I met these people who were running an organization there, it's called the Pioneer Society. And they have a collection and an archive and incredible things that relate to that era. So I found like, you know, original diaries that were written by people who went into the minefields or people who were coming over by boat. One diary was written by a man and his son together with little drawings of how landscape looked like when they were passing South America. Many things like that, photographs from that era, maps from the mines. And once you go into these archives, you cannot even imagine, I mean, I couldn't imagine before what I would find there, but it's just so rich in all kinds of detailed things, you know, leaflets that announce traveling theater troops coming through the mines and all these kind of things. The designer of the show picked up on the flag of San Francisco, which is a phoenix, and it has this yellow border around it. So the idea of like something that rises up from the ashes, which is sort of related, of course, to also the earthquake of 1906. So you have that yellow frame throughout the exhibition. There's one more image I think here from the exhibition. So yeah, for example, you have like this vitrine there that's filled with tools, like different types of hammer. Yeah, hammer. What's the plural for hammer?
Hammer.
No S.
Yes.
Hammers. Sounds kind of strange. Hammers. Then in the center there you have a piece by Paul Koss, a conceptual artist from San Francisco. He made this piece, The Sound of Ice Melting. It's a piece from 1967, and it's like these gigantic ice cubes, and they're surrounded by microphones that are supposed to pick up the sound of the ice melting. Really fabulous piece. Then on the other side there are pieces by Lynn Hirschman, who invented the fictional character Roberta Brightmore. She started doing that project in, at about like 73. So sort of pioneering really in that era, in that direction. When you see these images, that kind of course remind you very much of the photography of Cindy Sharman, only that they were done about 6 to 7 years earlier. There's a video by Anne Farm, that sort of architect, science artist collective, in the background you have these quilts that were made by a lady in Oakland that fascinated me. There's a huge tradition of crafts also in the Bay Area, specifically in the East Bay. So we brought in all of that. In the back is like a little drawing of Robert Bechtel juxtaposed with a panorama photograph of the earthquake. So the end really of the show and the beginning are sort of two different representations of San Francisco and street life there.
Jens?
Yeah.
Do you think is there any sort of relationship that can be drawn with your earlier studies in theater and a kind of theatrical approach to exhibition?
Absolutely, absolutely. Absolutely. I'm very interested in that. And the staging of the exhibitions has a lot to do with this, and also maybe the inclusion of non-art material as a sort of moment of alienation within the exhibition space that maybe draws you back to like a cultural and historical political context, you know, away from the works and back to maybe something that's more factual and more historical. That definitely comes through again and again in all of this. You know, and in a certain way I always think like that I'm continuing to direct just, you know, when you think about certain avant-garde practices within theater, you know, where it really is about taking the hierarchies of the mediums within theater apart, where you know, all of a sudden text becomes as equally important as the design and the music and the acting and everything. It's sort of, you know, is how you de-hierarchized. You know what I mean. Can anybody say that though?
Non-hierarchical.
Yeah, something like that. I have to look that up.
Can I, picking up on Shannon's question, like the difference between somewhat smaller institutions like WADIS or ICA and commercial galleries that don't have the infrastructure of what would formerly be installation design you know, teams, right? That like looking at the Getty, and you have a huge production plant of people who understand, oh, we're bringing over these. An example would be maybe like the Icon show, if anyone saw it, where the installation design completely overwhelmed this stuff coming in from Israel. I mean, it was this enormous production of a visual experience, but it was divorced from the curator and ultimately divorced from the art itself, and it just became a kind of thematizing to make up for either the lack of something or to make something bigger than it was. What role, in the absence of, you know, installation designers, do you play? I mean, going in there, if you can just kind of maybe walk through even the beginning with the ICA, with the colors and the fonts, and looking at the National Gallery. I mean, as a curator, or designing, or thinking about the vitrines for the painting exhibition, how much of a role do you play, down to the kind of details of understanding the visual experience as a designer, really, because it is design?
Well, yeah, that brings us back to what I said in the beginning about the author, you know, where like you have someone, and I'm always like looking, like, you know, one of my big heroes in film has been Jean-Pierre Melville, who was someone who would like absolutely coordinate and control every aspect of the film that he would do, and be particularly eminent about the details and the decor and the costumes and the sound and the light and everything like that. And I think that's really also how most of my shows come together, you know. I mean, I do the lighting, I do the graphics, I do the exhibition design, I do the design of the labels, everything.
So, like, okay, so, I mean, that's perfect. What does it feel like for you to experience, especially in larger museum operations, that done in a different manner, like a manner where you know that there is a group of people that come in to figure this out, not for the curator, because there's a dialogue, but what does it feel like to see this done the other, you know, from the other end up?
Well, what is interesting is that I've met people along the way that can do those things better than I can, and then I invite them to collaborate with me and actually have the experts do the graphic design, you know? I mean, you learn a lot, and especially from people who really know what they're doing. I mean, I had no idea. I know, for example, for artist favorites, you know, now what I did wrong in terms of certain fonts that I used, you know, I never do capitals with them. Well, I didn't know that because I had no idea about graphic design, and I never spoke to anyone, and I didn't have any money to actually talk to someone about it. But now it's, you know, different times, and you have made your experience, and you know, I actually really enjoy working with especially with graphic designers on the design of the publications and all, you know. But it's really a really strong collaboration, you know. I guess it would be like the equivalent of a film director working with a cameraman, or, you know, dramaturg in the theater company, the director, or something like that. It plays an enormous role, and I really want to be involved and until I feel satisfied with that. But the collaboration is good, because sometimes, many, many times actually, people come up with ideas that I couldn't even think about, you know? So it's sort of all this. I have never had the pleasure of working really with an exhibition architect, because that's like the next level, really. But I would like to do that at some point when there's the means financially to do that. Because I know there's some people whose work I've seen who have designed exhibitions that I was really blown away. All right, so this is a fun show. This is a show that opened about 4 weeks ago, and it's called The Wizard of Oz. Here, this is the entrance of the waters. You have this graphic up there, and these sort of like shadow figures. And it's all based on the original graphic design of The Wizard of Oz. It's the second show that I've done that is based on a novel. The first one was called Around the World in 80 Days, which I did in London at the ICA. And interestingly enough, at the ICA, are you all familiar with the story of Around the World in 80 Days? So there's this guy, Phileas Fogg, and it's like in the late 19th century, and he makes a bet that he can travel around the world in 80 days, and he's in this gentleman club on Pall Mall, which is this, you know, very well-known street in England or in London, where you have all these like sort of aristocratic gentlemen's clubs. And that happened to be just right next to the ICA. So when I was walking to the ICA one day, I passed by and said, wow, this is Pall Mall, this is a reform club. This is where Phileas Fogg did his bet. And Around the World in 80 Days was a book that my mother gave me when I was about 11 years old to learn, or to start to learn English. And I didn't think much of it at that time, but now thinking about it later on, it was sort of funny where, you know, you've been given a book that's actually written originally in French to learn English, and maybe it was also somehow something that had to do with how I grew up, you know, having been born in Costa Rica by, you know, parents of different nationalities and then growing up in the Middle East and in Germany. So there was this sort of confusion, perhaps, that sort of had to do with around the world in 80 days, you know, traveling to all these different places. So it somehow was a book that I remembered still vividly. And I'd been thinking about how to go back to literature, which maybe also relates again to this idea of, you know, theater and how you base maybe a project and a play or an exhibition on an existing text and try to find a sort of new interpretation, particularly of material that is so familiar with so many people. And Around the World in 80 Days kind of seemed to lend itself very well to this idea, because it was talking about this man who was traveling around the world in a time that was quite decisive of how, in my opinion, how we experience the world today, and in a way that it was really like the end of the, you know, Britain as a colonial empire. It was really the beginning of like the globalized world that we experience today through a lot of inventions that took place. You know, for example, the year before the book was written, the Suez Canal was opened, they built the railway in India, they had the steamboats, you know, really cutting the travel time of the oceans in half. They built the railway in the US. And Jules Verne, who wrote the novel, read an article about Thomas Cook, the travel agency that existed at that time or just began, offering a tour around the world in 80 days together with Thomas Cook. And it was also really then particularly the beginning of mass tourism, the way we experience it today. So it was sort of possible to actually, for someone, because of all these inventions and events, to travel around the world in 80 days. And in that exhibition, I invited artists who all in their work would address issues of migration, multiculturalism, post-colonial ideas, and they're all coming from countries that Phileas Fogg was traveling through, but we're now living in London. And I didn't bring any slides of that show, and I'm just saying that as an introduction. And my original idea was that it would be a trilogy of shows, Around the World in 80 Days, Peter Pan and Alice in Wonderland, all sort of like very iconic British fairy stories, all written in the late 19th century. And for Around the World in 80 Days, I invited the South London Gallery to participate as a collaborative institution because it was a larger exhibition. And they agreed to do that. And interesting, what was interesting about it was that the South London Gallery is located in a really different part of town. The ICA is right in the center of London, next to Buckingham Palace, you know, Piccadilly Circus, Trafalgar Square, the National Gallery, Horse Guards Parade, Big Ben. It's like really right in the middle. And South London Gallery is really on the outskirts, like a neighborhood that, you know, maybe in LA would be like South Central, kind of difficult and not as well off as the center of London. But, you know, huge immigrant population there. And so it was the idea that maybe you would take the trip around the world within an hour going by driving from one venue to the other. And you were entering the ICA gallery on day one, you know, with like texts taken out of the novel from day one. And we would leave the South London Gallery, we would exit it on day 80. And there were two pieces that I positioned there, sort of bookends, done by an artist from New Zealand called Janice Kerbel. And she made two really nice, small little drawings where she would make, for the beginning of the show, the star constellation over London on the day Phileas Fogg departed, because it's written in the book exactly which day and which time, and then the star constellation of the day and the time when he arrived back in London. And those were like sort of the bookends for the exhibition, starting with day one and day 80. You would walk through. The whole exhibition design itself was mimicking different elements from the Reform Club. So now, in coming to California, coming to the United States, I was looking for a book that would be much more quintessential American than Peter Pan or Alice in Wonderland. Of course, it has a more relationship to England and the history there. And the most obvious choice probably is The Wizard of Oz. Also because Baum's book is really the first totally fully American fairy tale, unlike other authors who have written fairy tales in the United States. Baum never actually used elements, characters, images, styles of European or Middle Eastern fairy tales as other authors did. So, you know, it's probably fair to say that Oz was really the first truly American fairy tale written in 1900. But since I was kind of interested in this idea of a trilogy, this is the beginning of a new trilogy, and hopefully this time we will go through with it. And the next one is going to be Moby Dick, is the second one, and the third one is The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. And I'm, of course, interested in exploring the history of the United States through those novels and through these exhibitions, but kind of, you know, doing this in a kind of maybe also playful way and looking behind the, you know, often multi-layered and complex themes that these books compose. So this is the first gallery here at the Waters, and I think there's about 32 artists in the show, of which I think probably 25 made new works, especially for the show. And the other ones were works that existed that I included because of their relationship to either the book, Baum, or some of the themes that the book was talking about. So in the back you see a series of Walker Evans photographs. These are photographs that he took in Alabama. I'm sure most of you are familiar with those. They were taken in 1935, and they really depict the harsh life of these people, like the poverty that still existed in the South in the mid-30s. And Walker Evans was writing a really interesting article about it, how he felt that he was like taken into a time machine and brought back to the previous century when he saw these people with no light, no electricity, no running water, and really living in conditions that he saw it didn't exist anymore in the mid-30s in the United States anymore. There are some images that clearly, of course, also make a very literal reference to Kansas, where Dorothy was from and where she lived, and the conditions of that life there. There's even a photograph in that series where you see a little girl sitting on the porch, maybe a girl that, in my opinion, somehow looked much more of a realistic version of Dorothy than the Judy Garland one that we all have in mind when we think about The Wizard of Oz. It was also important for me that those photographs were not from Kansas, but from Alabama, because I didn't want to really illustrate the book. It was much more about taking ideas and thoughts that came out of the book and things that are maybe related to American history and reconfigure them, go back and forth with our relations to the story and to the history of this country. So in the center here, this is a gray wall, and this is the first edition ever published of The Wizard of Oz. It was published in 1900, and there's like four copies, I think, that exist here in California, and we got this from a collector in Berkeley. And he also owns the 13 other books that Baum wrote about The Wizard of Oz. It was a whole series. We had these funny bookends. Oh, God. This book, the Scarecrow and the Tin Man, and they're actually from the 1970s. And there's a description written about all these elements. And this here is a copy of the New York Times review of The Wizard of Oz when it was published. And the review, it's a really positive review. They're really raving about the book. And in the center of the space, you see a piece by Felix Gonzalez Torres. It's called Untitled Passport. It's a part of this passport series that he made. And it's the size of a Cuban passport, and many of you know, obviously, that he was from Cuba and then later immigrated to the United States. But it's a passport that doesn't really carry any nationality. It has these black and white photographs of the sky and the clouds and the seagulls, and sort of metaphorically speaks about the seagulls as, you know, symbols of freedom and independence. They can fly over every border, every frontier. Maybe relate to Dorothy's song Somewhere Over the Rainbows, Where the Bluebirds Fly. So I kind of had these type of associations maybe with this piece. But I really thought of this as a beginning for the exhibition, and you kind of needed this passport in order to be allowed to go to Oz. And this is still the same room. is a wall painting by Donald Urquhart, an artist from London, who made a whole alphabet of us. So each letter of the alphabet is connected to some element from this, from the book or from the film. I don't know if I have another image of the alphabet. Well, can you see it the other way around? But I mean, have a look at what, like, there's like one really funny one that I like a lot, which is between the R and the S, which is like, R is for ruby slippers, S is for silver shoes, because in the book they're silver, in the movie they're red, and then on his little drawing they're actually arguing. Ruby slippers, no, silver shoes, ruby slippers. And the same with the W, it could stand for the wizard, but also the witch. So these kind of little jokes that he put in there. And Don has done several of these alphabet pieces, and he did one about Judy Garland, which he showed 2 years ago at the Jack Henley Gallery in San Francisco. And that's where I saw him doing a Judy Garland one, and I said to Don, who I'd worked with previously, wow, you should really do an alphabet of us, and that was our moment to do it. And turned out Donald was completely obsessed about the us and had read all the books and knew everything about it. So you come into the next space, in the center is a work by Evan Holloway, who you probably are familiar with, a sculptor here from Los Angeles, and Evan made a portrait of the Tin Man, and it's this machine with this axe, and you can activate it when you press some buttons, and then the axe goes up and chops the wood, and it makes an enormous sound. And he also put together this tribute concert to the Tin Man, and you can actually read in the pamphlet of the exhibition about this concert. And there's a little address that brings you to the YouTube site where you can see the Tin Man tribute band performing. So that's all part of the piece. And then on the blue wall there, these are four of the original drawings that W.W. Denslow made for the book. And these illustrations were really a paradigm shift in the history of illustration. Denslow was extremely celebrated once the book came out, and he actually got in a big fight with Bauman and never illustrated for him again. But I'm sure you've heard of Denslow before. So, like, I didn't know him before, but I thought since most of you are American, kind of like the illustrator of the 20th century. So there's six of the original drawings left, and we got four from the National Library of Congress, and they depict different plates that are actually their first edition. And this curtain is done by a German artist, Ulrich von Brandenburg, which speaks about like the theatricality of the Wizard of Oz, about the theatricality maybe also of the exhibition, and it's following a pattern of the curtain that is in the Globe Theatre in London, which still exists. So there's of course also the scene when Dorothy pulls away the curtain, and you know, she finds the wizard behind the curtain actually being the small guy where, you know, the whole time they were talking about the gigantic, almighty Wizard of Oz. This is again another look at the piece of Evan Holloway and the curtain, and in the back there's a tiny little piece here. And here, this is a loudspeaker inside the wall, and this is a roll that people use for a pianola. It has like a code inscribed on it that plays a song. And it's a piece by Caris Quinn Evans, who has done a lot of pieces that are based on Morse code, where he translates theoretical or philosophical texts into Morse code and then has them presented often through chandeliers that flicker in Morse code, or also blinds that move up and down to transport the Morse code, or these gigantic lights, these sort of defense lights that they used in the Second World War to look after airplanes. So here he translated the text or passages of the Oz text onto this roll, and had a pianola player put the roll in, and what you hear on through the loudspeakers is the piano sound of the text of Wizard of Oz in Morse code. And it's actually quite loud in the exhibition space. So you hear ding, 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 ding.
What is that artist's name?
Caris Quinn Evans. He's from London. You hear another look at this. Oh yeah, in the back there's these six paintings of Claire Ryers, a painter from San Francisco. She made a painting based on the scene of Dorothy in the poppy field. Spoke a lot about the idea of maybe how Dorothy's whole dream was maybe also like drug and related, and you know, always the story, especially in San Francisco, that, oh yeah, Baum smoked opium while he was writing The Wizard of Oz, and it's all like this psychedelic thing, which, you know, especially big in San Francisco, that story. So here's like Harrison Evans' piece a little bit closer. This is a piece here by Dominique Gonzalez Foerster. It's this carpet with 200 different books, and these are all books that she selected in relation to The Wizard of Oz and Baum and some of the scenes. So there's history books, there's art books, there's biographies, lots of science fiction stories, fantasy novels, and everyone who visits the exhibition is, you know, invited to sit down on the carpet and flip through these books, read them. People can also borrow them as long as they bring them back. And then next to it is a piece by Andy Warhol, Jackie Kennedy. It's one of the pieces. There's different Jackie portraits by Warhol, and this is one is based on a photograph that was taken at the funeral of JFK. And for me, Jackie sort of represented maybe what Dorothy would have been like if she would have been a grown-up woman. And, you know, two women who were kind of like two female icons of America in the 20th century who sort of struggled, had to find their way, maybe one more sort of psychologically and the other one more physically by going back to Kansas. Witnessing kind of like an important moment in American history, one fictional, one, you know, real, but kind of through all the presentation of her as a character in the media, kind of maybe semi-fictional, no one really knew her in the end. And of course also Warhol in the exhibition as someone who used popular culture as a departing point for his work. Lots of people struggled with this piece in the exhibition. Who is Jackie doing there? Okay, so the yellow wall in the back there has the ruby slippers in a little vitrine. I think there's about like 8 different ruby slippers that all claim they're the original ruby slippers. That's one of them. And next to it is like portraits of the main characters of the 1939 film. So this yellow wall is really about the film. And the colors for these different walls that you have seen, the gray one, the blue one, the yellow one, the green one, and there's a red one, they're all the colors that were used in the book by Dan Snow to illustrate the different countries that Dorothy walks through, like Munchkin Country and Kansas, of course, in the beginning, then at the Emerald City. So each of these places, Winky Country, they all have their colors in the book. So I put them throughout the exhibition really as sort of display devices that help you to, you know, really move through the story, and they're placed chronologically in accordance to where they occur in the book. And the piece on the wall, this is like many, many little ribbons. These ribbons all have text printed on them. It's a piece by Ivani Neuschwan, an artist from Brazil, who lives in Belo Horizonte. It's the third largest city in Brazil. And in the northeast of Brazil, they have this tradition that you take these little ribbons and you put them around your wrist and you make 3 knots. And if the ribbon falls off, the wish that is printed on it is going to become true. So here there's about like 500 different wishes printed on those ribbons, and the audience can take any ribbon they like, any wish they feel like they would like to have, and put it around. And they have the option to write their own wish on a little card. There's a little shelf provided for that, and they can roll it together and put it into the hole where the ribbon comes out. And that piece relates to, of course, the wishes that the 4 main characters have, you know, Dorothy's wish to go home, the Tin Man's wish to have a heart, the Diane's wish to have courage, and the Scarecrow's wish to have a brain. It's the most popular piece in the exhibition. And the wishes that we exhibit here are all the wishes that people are writing down in the previous venue where it was shown in the Carnegie Museum for the Carnegie International. So all the San Francisco wishes will then go to where this piece is being exhibited next. And down here, you see the leftovers of an event that happened during the opening. It's a piece by an artist called Loris Graillot, a French artist. And Loris had the idea that he wanted to make a cyclone. And the cyclone would contain confetti made of Oz books. So when you entered the waters in the entrance, we had this confetti machine that we kind of customized so that it would actually blow in a circle, And I think we bought like about like maybe 150 or 250 paperbacks of The Wizard of Oz. They had like this penguin edition that cost $1.50, and put them in a shredder to have like these non-confetti pieces and the round ones. And I think Logis' idea was that there's on the one hand this destructive element to it, that you destroy the story and you create something new out of it, but you also create a celebration and create something joyful. At the opening, this whole thing was just blowing everywhere, and there was really a confetti parade like you have on Fifth Avenue when the astronauts are coming back. It was very nice. Then this is a neon piece that's done by Glenn Liger, America, and the front of the neon piece is black, so you only see it projected. I hope this is not going to crash now.
I think it thinks that you will, actually. Are you on PowerPoint right now?
You know what it is? It's like a... It's not my version. I took this from someone else. And when they are in the network, and sometimes it happens. No, I'm not. It's, sorry. If I go to show now, then it just goes there.
Yeah.
No, it starts in the beginning.
You could select the slide that you want.
Yeah, tell me.
If you go back to the other view on the bottom corner there, those little icons.
Okay, wait. You have to do it like this.
You just click on escape, then you go back.
I click on escape. You hear this? Okay. So where were we?
Lee Gonis in Wizard of Oz.
Are you just clicking through?
Glenn Ligon, right. This is a piece that's going to be in all three shows. It's going to be in Moby Dick. It's going to be also in Huckleberry Finn. And for in the Wizard of Oz, it sort of had a lot to do with like how I was looking at the Wizard of Oz, like there's this promise of this other land beyond the rainbow, but there's also this darkness of Kansas and the darkness of America at that particular time. And maybe also, of course, Glenn Ligon as an African American artist plays here also with the colors and his kind of perception maybe of America. But I kind of said like, okay, America is kind of dark on the front, but there's still this promise maybe in the back. I know that sounds like a bit romantic and naive, but I guess it's also about the piece that we presented for me in the context of Oz. Oh yeah, here's this green wall, which I'll just quickly tell you that the projection of the first film ever made of The Wizard of Oz was done by Baum himself in 1910. Once the book became really popular, Baum actually produced a musical and then was approached to make a film from that musical, and this is the film. The film wasn't a commercial success at all. Here you look again into the other gallery, and then on the left you have a film by Bruce Conner, and it's called Wild Trees. And well, Bruce Conner is really one of my favorite artists, someone who I only discovered really in depth when I moved to San Francisco, where he lived. He died about 8 weeks ago, just like 3 days before the opening of the show. And Bruce Conner was born in Kansas, like Dorothy, and he grew up on a farm just like Dorothy, and this particular film is all about his relationship to Kansas. So it's an autobiographical film about Conner in Kansas with all this found footage material that relates to his home state and his upbringing there. And it gets really fantastic at times with women on the lawn training for synchronized water swimming, and very strange. And then it comes always back to these kind of like moments where you go on a farm, you see animals, and it starts with a little boy going to bed, and then it ends with that same boy waking up. And I think in some texts it was also suggested that it was sort of like a sexual dream that the boy has had. And the boy obviously is Connor. But the nice thing about this, the coincidence also, that in the film, Dorothy is taken away through the cyclone, and when she comes back, she actually just wakes up in the bed. And that's the moment when like all these other characters from the farm come around, and they all look like the characters that she met on her journey, and it's sort of unclear whether all of this was just a dream or not. The next gallery was all about Dorothy's problem of, like, on the one hand, you know, this idea of there's no place like home, I really want to go back to Kansas, and then her whole thing about Samba over the rainbow, I need to leave, you know, this is like the promised land that I want to go to. So I guess it's sort of like a conflict that many of us are familiar with. You know, we want to go out and explore the world, but we also like the comfort of where we come from and the security and safety of this. So here, these are two paintings by Robert Bechtel, San Francisco painter, who has been working in this photorealistic style for probably about 50 years. Really never done anything else than making these paintings of street scenes in the Bay Area. He did a couple of landscape watercolors at some point, but I guess 90% of his work is really about these type of photorealistic street scenes. They're kind of uncanny, maybe have also an anthropological quality, as they sort of are about capturing a moment that maybe is about to disappear in the life of that region in the United States. What is particular about these two works here is that the right one is a painting of the house that he grew up in, and the left one is a night scene of the house where he's living in right now, and now he's 76 years old, sort of all comes full circle here. But it's really about, you know, he never left the Bay Area, he never lived anywhere else. One painting is made in Oakland, in Alameda, that's where he grew up, and then the other one is made in San Francisco in Potrero Hill, which is about two blocks away from where the waters is. And on the other side, you have these five photographs of Simran Gill. It's an artist who lives in Sydney, was born in Singapore by Indian parents and grew up in Indonesia. And she's sort of like, for me, pretty much the archetypical global artist. She's very much immersed in post-colonial theory, lectures on that, teaches on that, but also makes work. And these are five photographs all taken on different continents with her as a plant in the vegetation of the particular places that she's in. And then there's the red field there, there's a little gramophone playing somewhere over the rainbow, and together with the record cover of the first soundtrack published in 1939, and the sheet music that you can buy in order to play somewhere over the rainbow on your piano. And then the last piece here in this room is this projection. You can't really see it so well. It's a film by Jennifer Bornstein. It's called Voyage to Samoa. It sort of brings together the Simran Gill piece and the Robert Bechtel piece in the way that this is a journey that Jennifer made without ever leaving Los Angeles. She filmed pages out of a book that documents a trip to this island Samoa in the South Sea, and just films these different images. I think there's about five different photographs that she films from that book. It's very tropical and lush. And then she puts this emerald green filter over it to, you know, ties it in again with like the Wizard of Oz, Emerald City. And then the last piece, which is a huge video installation, it's a piece by Steve McQueen, an artist from London who is living in Amsterdam. And it's a large film, I want to show it to you again. It's a large film installation that contains over 400 images that NASA sent into space in the 1970s on a satellite. And it's filled with images from people all around the world, with mathematical, physical formulas, The idea was really that at some point aliens would find a satellite and maybe have an idea of what life is like on this planet. The interesting thing about these images and all of it is there's no poverty, there's no war, there's no financial crisis, there's no unemployment, there's nothing bad happening on planet Earth. So it's sort of like an Oz. This is sort of like a utopia that's depicted there. And I put it as the last piece of the show because I saw that, you know, rather than thinking of the idea that Oz is somewhere over the rainbow far away, maybe it's just right in front of our face and we just have to make the best out of it. So that's sort of the final thing that happened there. And that's also the end of the presentation. Thank you very much.
Well, we have 5 minutes if people want to ask a question.
I was curious, Jens, about how your idea of how you want to work with artists as a curator has changed over the years that you've been working, because I noticed in the beginning of those first two examples that you showed us of artist choice, artist favorites, and surprise, surprise, you're pretty much sort of allowing, you have an overarching concept, but you're allowing the artist to choose their own work, and then how it all comes together is sort of the ultimate challenge in terms of how you design the show and place it. But then towards the end, it seems like you're sort of working more intensively with, you know, both historical work and contemporary artists on, you know, kind of interesting, broad, somewhat challenging themes. So I was just curious how that, you know.
It really depends from exhibition to exhibition, and then there's still shows where you have maybe a format that is more closely to something like artist favorites, and then you have shows like The Wizard of Oz where you select existing pieces, and also work and commissioning artists to make new work. But of course, I mean, at some point, I think that something like The Wizard of Oz, where we have a lot of commissions, is also only possible because of maybe in some cases or most cases, longer relationships with artists, who feel comfortable and talking to you about, making something that's for a very specific exhibition, so there's no issue about maybe, I don't know if that's something we were going towards to subscribing from the artist to a certain concept that they had to fulfill.
Not really. I mean, I was curious because the first couple of examples that you gave were not so much about the curator sort of choosing the work, but more about the curator sort of defining the concept and then the artist choosing the work. That seems to have changed a little bit, but I don't know if I'm just reading into the trajectory as you.
I think it really depends from exhibition to exhibition, and then. As I said in the beginning, I mean, choosing the works is one thing, but I think the other things that are around that. I'm going to make my computer speak. The other things around it are really, really important, as well. The installation and, the design and all these kind of elements. But there is a shift, I think, in a little bit in what I do. Maybe not even that much in these exhibitions, but maybe the exhibitions that I did before were much more conceptual and much more self-referential and really about understanding the concept of an exhibition in itself and almost tests or trials or things where I would really conceptualize the idea of making a show, the show that I did here in Los Angeles in 2001, which was really about me coming here, being invited by a gallery to do a show there 2 weeks before they wanted to have the opening. It's like, Christian, 2 weeks? What am I supposed to do? I don't even know this city very well. But then, just turning it on its head and saying, well, why don't we do the whole research and the exploration and all of this while the show is going on, and I just, bring everything in that I find, and it sort of becomes this big collection of things that Jens has found during, his 3 month stay here in Los Angeles. So it kind of was very much about taking apart also, I guess, certain structures of exhibitions and then presenting them to the audience. You could come in and every day there would be a new work, and every day you would change the installation. You had these walls with the wheels underneath, so you could move them around and change the position of things. It was great.
I have a question. It might be a little bit off topic because you didn't talk specifically about But when you mentioned the sort of shift in curatorial practice towards a more, the curator becoming more of a creative author, I'm wondering if you could talk about that, an element of that shift as it pertains to artists being sort of exhibition designers, being that being like an assumption or an expectation that already like the artist knows exactly how it's all supposed to be. So do you know what I mean? Like, is that
I've never heard of that.
Well, I mean, it seems to me like, well, maybe I could say it a little differently, that there's some kind of, when you talk about the sort of older model of like, okay, the curator has the sort of expertise, it's making this selection or whatever. Well, at a certain point, it seems like, based on my experience of speaking with other artists or other curators, it's like, well, you sort of get invited, and that's kind of like, at some point, maybe on a very low level, the extent of the curator is sort of, you know,
yeah,
and
yeah.
So there's this kind of like, whatever the artist wants to do, and then we'll just make it happen.
Oh, okay.
I'm talking about,
I mean,
I'm being very general.
Yeah.
But.
I know what you mean.
You know
what I'm saying? Yeah.
And in a way, and another thing, I guess I'm trying to get at this sort of unspoken kind of moment of an artist and the curator working together to make an exhibition kind of work. Do you know, like,
mm-hmm.
Can you just speak?
Well, I think what you were saying is interesting because you were like talking about this. There's a particular form which is probably just really lazy, where like people just invite artists and then, oh yeah, well, you can do the rest of the work. I'm not even really sure why I invited you, but well, you know, everyone knows Francis Dark and it looks nice on the invitation card, which is somehow that what we did with Surprise Surprise as a strategy, you know? But then actually talking to the artists really carefully about what show pieces that we wanted to show.
But I mean, I guess it's bad
curating as much as there's big bad art.
Yeah, I think that, well, I guess what I feel like in a way, my perception of that, and it is a qualitative comment, because I'm saying it's not, you know, it's not like the greatest curating job or something. But on some level, that built into that is the expectation of, well, the artist really knows best, and they are going to do it a certain way, you know, and I'll let them do it. Or even to the point of like, I'm not sure what I'm going to write for the catalog, or I'm not sure what I'm going to write for the pamphlet, or I'm not sure what I'm going to write on the wall. I mean, you don't know how many times I've been in this situation. So it's like, I think, I'm just kind of curious if you, from your perspective, if you just, I mean, I guess you just said it.
I get curious, I get upset because there are people doing this kind of stuff, and it's my profession that I really care and I'm passionate about. And if you tell me that people who operate like this, then it's really a disgrace to what we do. Sorry. I know that. I've seen curators installing a group show, walking around with the artists, telling them how to install the show, or even talking to the technicians about how to do it. Now maybe that's clever because they do it all the time, but still, like, what's going on there? You know, how is that possible?
But see, I mean, I guess what I'm sort of loaded question is that I think part of it's possible because there's an assumption that the artist is the be-all, end-all, so it's like...
To a certain degree, that's true.
Right.
But I mean, you know, like think about an example that maybe more familiar to some people. Like these big exhibitions that are sort of theme shows. I don't know, like my dear friend Hans Ulrich always made this exhibition called Utopia Station for the Venice Biennial, and I think they invited about 150 artists to make a poster about the idea of the utopia. I mean, what are you going to do with that? And that was really the extent of what happened there. You know, I didn't get upset. I'm just like, well, you know, it's just one of those things, and they happen all the time. But it's difficult, I think, and I don't know how it can satisfy anyone involved—the artist, the curator, or even the audience.
In regards to that,
but I think what you say, there is an expectation from the side of the curator to say, oh yeah, they will figure it out. You know, but I expect this from artists too, but in a different way. You know, I expect them to come forward with an idea, with some thoughts, and then we have the dialogue.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
I propose something that they can, you know, it's like what we were doing, playing ping pong there before. You know, like I take the ping pong ball, I throw it over, the artist goes back, and we have this back and forth. You know.
Charlie,
what were you? I was just going to say that it seems, I mean, overall, with looking at curatorial efforts, I may be wrong, it feels like the ratio of artists that you work with that are kind of committed to you and will produce works for your effort is high, and I'm just wondering how that kind of comes about, like the number of people, let's say with the Wizard of Oz, who are going to basically generate works in relationship to the show, opposing, following the track of you have the idea and the research and the relationships results in bringing in work, existent works. Obviously the existent things in the Wizard of Oz almost are more of a kind of Smithsonian-esque, I mean they're things, they're not artist productions of the original copy of the book or the full collection of the books, those decisions. But kind of, if you kind of go through, maybe going with that ping pong metaphor of they could have a work, is there a part of you that even though they could have a work, that you would rather them kind of generate a work for the show?
No. I think when I invite them to do this, then I know whether or not I want to have that work that exists, or I want to have them make a new work. It also depends on the budget that you have. Sometimes you have enough money to for the shipping, but not enough money for the commission, or the other way around, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. So these also are things that are very practical, that in the end also influence some decisions, you know? Mm-hmm. But, you know, I like often also working with artists repeatedly, because I like to establish a certain relationship where you can both grow together and explore different things. And you know, one of these relationships is, for example, with an artist called Tino Segal, who I've worked with really, really closely. I did 3 solo exhibitions of him at the ICA, and he's doing a permanent exhibition at the Waters. It's like a retrospective of his work. We began showing his earliest work, and every 6 weeks we show a new piece. So it's sort of a retrospective that is developing while he's still developing as an artist, still producing. I mean, the guy's barely 30 years old now. So he's sort of playing, of course, also with the concept of the retrospective as an exhibition model, and all of those kind of things play a role, which relates to Tino's practice again, where one piece is generated out of the other, and where maybe, you know, certain elements of institutional critique come in. And so it was sort of made sense that we found that format for the exhibition. But I mean, that's really like the closest relationship that I've had. So what we're doing now at the Waters for the next 3 years is like a big rethink of like the institutional structure and how to maybe really think differently about art institutions in general. And what I want to do is sort of continue with certain elements that we have had so far. Like, we have this residency program, for example, that's called Capstree Project. There's 2 artists coming to San Francisco. They're with Capstree, which is under the roof of CCA. And they have an apartment, they have a studio, they they're supposed to make an exhibition, we make a catalog with them, and that's being shown then at the Waters. And while they're there, they also teach 1 or 2 classes with the MFA or the curating program. Then we have this sort of longer relationship, for example, with Tino Segal, but there's also other artists, like Bruce Conner, for example, has been in all my group shows at the Waters so far. And so there are certain elements that I'm like looking at. So what actually is going to happen for the next 3 years, starting September of next year, is that we're going to work exclusively for 3 years only with 6 artists. And these 6 artists will, over the course, do 2 solo exhibitions, 1 with existing works and 1 a new commission. They will all have the chance to spend at least one Capstree residency there. So they'll be in San Francisco for 3 months. We have 4 meetings throughout the year where all of the artists come together, work together with the students, and each of them is going to do another project that somehow relates to one of the programs in the school that are not MFA or curating, so architecture, design, literature, these kind of things that happen there as well. So overall, it's like something that, you know, where we try to focus much more on the environment and the situation being in the school, but it's still at the same time generating, you know, relatively general shows. And within that, I will do like this trilogy of shows at the Moby Dick and the Huckleberry Finn, where all of those 6 artists will participate. So that's like, kind of like maybe now making the step of trying to find new formats for exhibitions to trying to find a format for an institution. You know, that sort of similarly tries to find its way within a particular condition and environment.
And who are the 6?
I've only one confirmed, and the other ones here taught the talking. Harold Fletcher is going to be one of them. And he has been from San Francisco. He studied at CCA, and he lives now in Portland. But the other ones we're talking to. It's important that the group is not only about my six favorite artists. I think you need people who are able to deal with these other programs, who are able to teach, who can make the commitment, who also as a group function, who have an experience in teaching, who are within their careers at that point where they want to do a sort of residency and get involved with this. So, there's a list of probably 20 people that I'm seeing over the course of this year, half of which I've spoken to. I'm trying to figure this out, but it's exciting, and I'm extremely happy that I'm able to